and let us talk about subgroups. So, similarly, even groups can have subgroups. What is the meaning of a subgroup? A subgroup would mean a collection of elements, not all elements, some of the elements within a group that form a group by themselves. And when I say they form a group by themselves, it means that they should satisfy those four properties: closure, identity element, reciprocity, associativity. All right? Do you see a subgroup here? Now, this is something that you are going to work out, G6-2. And when I say G6-2, what I definitely mean is that there is G6-1 as well. Okay? So, this is something that you can work out with not much difficulty. So, I am just giving you the answer. Now, looking at this, can you see some subgroup?
EDF.
E?
EDF.
Oh, you have seen the difficult one first. Very good. But is there a subgroup of order 2? EDF is correct. Yeah. This is the easiest to see perhaps. EAAE. E and E form a group, right? Right? And what is the order of that subgroup? 2. Actually, I should have written G, but I corrected in the slide later on, but generally we write G for the order of subgroup. Okay. So, how many subgroups of order 2 do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, EA, EB, EC, ED, EF, is that right? Right? Of course, in this class, two positives can make a negative. If I ask right twice, then it usually implies that it is not right. It is not right. Look at say E and D. And what our friend said is right actually. Look at E and D. If E and D form a subgroup, then I should be able to construct a 2 by 2 multiplication table, ED, DA, ED, ED, right. So, if I write ED and ED here, then what do I have in DD? DD is F, right, which is somewhat related to our grading system. DD is almost F, is not it? So, DD is F, that means E and D do not form a group, right. So, this is gone. What about EF? Look at FF. FF is D, right? That is also gone. Okay, what about C? Let's see. What is CC? CC is E. Oh, so what is CC? No, CC is E. There is no problem with that. Okay? So, I can write EC, EC, and that will be a subgroup, no issue with that. What about EB? What is BB? It is E, so no problem. So, I have three subgroups of order 2, right? And as he has seen already, we have a subgroup of order 3 also, EDF. Look at the highlighted elements. Are you convinced that they form a group? EDF, EDF, what is there? Here you have EDF, and then of course this will also be, I should have highlighted these as well. This is EDF, and then you have F here and D here, and these are E. So, EDF also form a subgroup, right? So, you have a subgroup of order 3. G equal to 3, G equal to, small g equal to 3, small g equal to 2, all right? Anything else?
EBCD.
EBCD would be kind of trivial because EBCD can be broken down further into, no, EBCD will not be, you have to include F as well, isn't it? Even if you try to make EBD, you will find that F will be required because don't forget DD is F, right? If D is there, you cannot do without F, right? Any other possibility? But can you construct a subgroup like EAC? If I take EAC, will that be a subgroup or not? Let us check. AA, what is AA? E. What is AC? D. Doesn't work. There is nothing else actually. We have exhausted all possibilities, right? There are 3 subgroups of order 2 and there is 1 subgroup of order 3. What is the order of the group? 6, right? It's written G6. So now does the Dimag Ki Batti go on? 3, 2, 6. You see the correlation? 2 and 3 are both divisors of 6, isn't it? Right? Well, EDF is a cyclic group, don't forget that. But the point is, 2 and 3 are divisors of 6. Okay. This is a manifestation of a general principle that the order of a subgroup is always a divisor of the order of the group. Right. So this has to happen and we will prove it. This has to happen. Order of a subgroup has to be a divisor of the order of the group. So since this is, since the order of the group here is 6, subgroups cannot be anything other than 2 and 3. All right? Can you have a subgroup of order 1? Well, that will be there for everything, right? That is E. The only group of order 1 that can be there is that of E, only one element. Okay? Fine. So this is something that we are going to now prove, that the order of a subgroup G is a divisor of the order of the group H. Fine. So let us consider that there are G elements of the subgroup A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, etc. up to AG. Okay? And let us consider another element B which is not in the subgroup. Alright? Now, if I multiply B with A1, B with A2, B with A3 and so on and so forth, what do I get? I get some element which should be an element of the group, but will it be inside the subgroup? BA1, BA2, BA3? There will be G products, right? Between B and the A's. And I think everybody understands that this BA1, BA2, BA3, etc. cannot be members of the subgroup, cannot be elements of the subgroup. They are not members of the subgroup, but they are members of the group. Okay? Let's look at that example, G62. EDF form a group, right? Take any element other than E, D and F. Take A. What is DA? DA is B. What is FA? It is C. B and C are outside the subgroup. But there will better be in the group, right? Otherwise closure will not be satisfied. All right. So see, it is closure that is telling us that the products cannot be members of group, of the subgroup. Because B is outside the group. That's what I'm saying. B is outside the subgroup, right? So if a product of B and an element of the subgroup is within the subgroup, then it means that the subgroup does not satisfy closure. Is that right? So what we have is a contradiction. If we say, we start with the premise that B is outside the subgroup and then we say that BA1 or maybe BA5 is within the subgroup, then we are saying that closure is not satisfied for the subgroup. If the subgroup is not a group, then what are we talking about? Right? This is one part of the story. The other part of the story is that after all, B and A5 are both members of the group. So, BA5 has to be an element of the group as well. Okay? So, that is what we are saying. It's clear? Now, see what has happened. So, just for B, how many elements have you generated? How many elements are there in the group? In the subgroup? G number of elements are there in the subgroup. For B, how many elements that you have you generated? G more. So, what is the total number? 2G. Right? So, for each element outside, you are going to generate G number of elements. Okay? So, finally, you have to stop somewhere or the other if it is a finite group. So, what you would have had then is that something like NG or KG, and that would be the order. Right? So, the order of the group has to be something like KG, where K is an integer. Understood? Because every element will behave like B, and every element outside the subgroup is going to generate G number of elements by multiplication. So, total number has to be KG, where K is an integer. So, H, so G has to be a divisor of H. Alright? So, nice mathematical riddle. Does it have anything to do with chemistry? No? Yes. Don't forget what we have discussed already. Start from octahedron. We said that C3V is a subgroup of octahedron because you get C3V by substituting how many elements? Two elements like this. Actually, that is not right, isn't it? Three elements. Three elements. I have to correct that. Some of it has gone unnoticed. But what about this? This side? This is D4H, this is C4V, this is C2V. Right? By different substitutions. Now look at the orders, forget everything else, look at the orders. This is H and these are all G's, isn't it? Not really H, I should write G's. Okay. This is 48, on this side order is 6. Is 6 a divisor of 48? Yes. What about 16? Yes. 8, well if 16 is a divisor, then 8 and 4 have to be divisors. Okay. So, this is a manifestation of a chemical manifestation of the fact that the order of let me put it the other way now, I have been saying the same thing again and again. Let me just turn it around and say that the order of the group is going to be an integral multiple of the order of any subgroup, right? And this, what we have here, is a nice chemical manifestation of this mathematical principle. Okay? And another instance that should convince us that these two discussions are not divorced from each other. Right. So, I think I will end here today, it is almost 6:30. I will end with this concept of similarity transformation. Similarity transformation is like this, where A, B, X are all members of the group. What? I noticed it. X inverse A, X. This inverse should not be there. So, once again, peril of copy paste. Fine. X inverse A, X. That is called similarity transformation, where A, B, X are the elements of the group. So, A and B are called similarity transforms of each other. They are also called conjugates of each other. Okay? So, a class is defined as a complete sets of elements that are, the correct spelling would be conjugate to each other. So, if I have a complete set of elements within a group that are conjugates to each other, then they comprise a class. What is the meaning of a complete set? What is complete set? What is a complete set that you studied in maybe quantum CH4 to 5 or some such course? Let us close with this question. Actually, you know the answer. You should think. Let us close with this question and come back on Friday. The answer is so easy that if I tell you what the answer is, you are going to throw up your hands in the air. So, you figure it out. The answer has actually been discussed in today's class also. Anyway, So, we come back on Friday then and start from here. We start with this slide, similarity transformation, talk a little bit about classes and properties of similarity transformation, and then we can move over to matrices. After all, we started this discussion with transformation matrices, and then we will go ahead and see how we can reach the great orthogonality theorem. Okay.